are important component of the whole thing. We will see that. One thing that is very important is that yoga is a science. When we say science, the science does not depend upon any particular understanding. Like you don't say that it is Einstein physics is different from Newton's physics and all that. It's all the same. The same way about yoga, there is nothing like a personality based yoga. Yoga is a science that we need to have. So what the university has been doing is to see that, take it as a science. Now there are two important aspects when we say science. Often people think that science is different from yoga and all that. Actually it is the same. Like the way science is also trying to understand the nature. And then yoga is also a practice which goes back to the nature. A lot of people say that we have conquered the nature. I don't think that's the right way of expression. It's an expression of arrogance. The science has understood nature so that we get the best use of it. That's the only thing. Like for example, the nature has the gravitation from which the water flows down. So we build a dam to see that we get the best advantage out of it. We have not conquered the nature, but we have understood nature. So when you understand the nature outside, that's what we basically need the science. But whereas when you understand inside, that's what is basically the idea of yoga. So the inquiry is the same, trying to understand and make the best use of it. When you know yourself, you can make the best use of yourself. That's what is the simple principle that yoga gives us. So we will see that what is deep inside our nature in these two sessions of talks that we are going to have. But in between, we also do the practice to see that how we are going to go back to that. Like the way science and technology, when you look at it, science is something which is about the knowledge and the technology is its application. The same way that yoga philosophy is what is called as the knowledge of yoga and the practice of yoga is its application. When we don't have both of them together, then this practice of yoga becomes dogmatic. Then these people start saying that my yoga is better than your yoga. My teacher knows better yoga than your teacher. All these problems will come. So let us try to understand it from a scientific way. That's why we started this particular university. Now, it is as old as the mankind itself. That means right from the beginning this yoga has been there. I have another presentation of ideas about the origin and the history of yoga where I present 10,000 years ago. There are evidences about yoga being in the society and then later on how over a period of time you can continuously see that it has been alive, people have been going through that. Now, the whole practice of these practices of yoga has been more like the practices of the energy which is there in the body, and the body energy is what is called as prana. It's also called as chi or ki. Like when a simple idea is that you want to move the hand, you can just move the hand like that. There is a life force which is moving the hand. So basically, it may be literally I'm moving the hand, but actually what is happening is prana is making the movement possible. And prana is called as chi. Therefore, during the time of Buddha, later on, immediately these practices went to the east as chi practices. That's why we have Om Chi, Chi Gong, Kai Chi. And Chi and Ki, both these things are the same way as you. So Reiki, all these practices into the west, into the east, where it went. From Afghanistan, it went to China. From China, it went down to Japan. It went as Chi practices. But when it went to the west, later on about 400 years ago, when the first Dutch people came to India, and then later on British, and they have taken to the West, they took it more like physical practice. Unfortunately, what happened? The same thing which reached America, more like a physical exercise. But otherwise, this has nothing to do with the physical, but it is more with the inner personality. So, so much it happened like that. Today, I have to say that yoga is more spiritual than physical. That is how basically the whole distraction has taken place. This year becomes very important because that it has been, UNO has declared this year to be the first time that International Day of Yoga, or World IDY, on the June 21st it is declared. Why on June 21st? Because that's supposed to be the longest day of the year. So that is how on that day yoga has been promoted as the international activity. Almost 177 countries are preparing to do some activity or the other in the practice of yoga. So we are also taking part in that, and I have some slides to show later on maybe about how people are involved in that. Now, because that yoga has been a science, that we need to understand what yoga is. In fact, I can go on deriving, giving the definitions of yoga from the last 10,000 years, but I don't want to give you its kind of definitions and, you know, explain about that. Rather than that, I thought I will derive the definition of yoga so that we will understand what yoga is, and then we can exactly follow how we have to practice that yoga. So, the first thing is that there are several questions which can really make us understand about yoga. Like, what is happiness can lead us to understanding about yoga? Or what is the purpose of life can lead us to understanding about yoga? But one question that I take up is, who am I? See, this question is a very philosophical question in Indian philosophy. People who are beyond Indian artists will know very clearly that this is a question so powerful. A small, ordinary, simple school boy by name Venkata Ramana took up this question so seriously, later on he became Ramana Maharshi. That means this question is so powerful that it can make a big yogi out of an ordinary simple school boy called Venkata Ramana. So, such a question can also explain about yoga. So, let us try to understand that. Now, when you question who am I, basically it is to understand who is a human being. Why it is important? Because we are all human beings. A dog will not have that question. A tiger will not have that question. But only thing is, it's a human being. We need to have that question. Unfortunately, what happens is, whole life goes on using this I, right, left and middle and all that, saying that I'm angry, I'm hungry, you upset me, you disturb me, I have this, I have that. This I we have been using all the time, never even finding out who is this I. So that's what is the simple question of who am I. Understanding about the human. There are two ways of understanding it. One is the way modern science adapted, understanding human being by looking at it from outside. When they look at a human being from outside, dissected, they found out there is a digestive system, respiratory system, circulatory system, all these things are there. But what can be perceived by the sensory organs, they only found out that. Because that was the limitation. Another way of approach of looking at the human being is from inside. In fact, when you look at it from outside, even the mind and what is there behind the mind, you don't understand it. Only when later on somebody like Sigmund Freud came onto the scene and started saying that, hey, human being is not just only this physiology, but he's also mind, psychology. So psychosomatic, somatopsychic, all these ideas have come. But Indian philosophy, long time ago, looked at human being not just only at two personality level, but they looked at human being at five personality level, which is popularly known as Panchamoksha. How did they find out that human being exists at five personality level? It is because the method of inquiry they adapted is looking inwards. And now I cannot look into somebody else inwards, I can look into myself. So each one of us, we have to look into ourselves, our own life experience, out of which we need to find out who is this I. So therefore, this it's a very beautiful dialogue that goes on between the student and teacher. The student is Guru and the teacher is Varuna. The discussion goes on. Guru is Varanihi, Varuna is the Karapasasara, Adihi Bhagavo Brahmi. This is all recorded 6,000 years ago in a text called the Upanishad. The student goes to the teacher and asks, who am I? I'm just cutting short all the discussion. The teacher says, find out for yourself and tell me who you are, your own experience of who is that I. The student comes back in no time and tells the teacher that I found out I am this physical body. And this physical body is made out of food. Food is called as Anna. Therefore, he calls it as Annamaya Koksha, made out of food. As long as the food is given, so long as body is there. As long as the body is there, I am there. And that body is not there, I am not there. So where are you today this morning? I'm in this yogic seminar because my physical body is here. So I'm this physical body. The student comes back to the teacher and says, I'm this physical body.
That's what we're first level.
My emotion. The teacher says, find out further. That means you are not physical body, but you are something behind it. It's not very difficult to find out because the physical body by itself does not move. It has to have the life force behind it. My mouth does not speak. There should be a life force because of which the speaking takes place. My eyes do not see. Because of the life force, the eyes are seeing. The life force is seen through the eyes actually. So therefore, who am I? I am the prana. The prana is the life force, vital force. Prano brahmi vyajana, prana theva kalvimani bhuta vyajayati. I am this prana. Probably this fellow came across a dead body around which people are sitting and crying. Why are you crying? They said the person is no more. Why do you say no more? I see the whole body there. Hands are there, legs are there, eyes are there, ears are there, everything is there. Yeah, everything is there, but life was there a couple of hours ago. And now the life is gone. He's gone. This body is useful for 60, 70, 80, 100 years as long as the life force is here. But the moment life force is gone, he is gone. Now this body is now only for disposal, that's all. We all know that. So therefore, who am I? I am this pranamaya kosha or the life force personality. Not only in this body, the prana is gone and gone. Even in this body, living body, there the life force is not there, I am not there. That's our own experience. Look at your nails and hair. There is no life force there. That's why your nails grow and you pick the nails, it doesn't hurt you because you are not there. Only thing is, while cutting the nails, if somebody touches your skin, immediately you cry. Why? Not because the physical body is there, but because the prana is there. See, prana is hurt, then you are hurt. Prana is not hurt, you are not cut. Similarly, hair. You sit in front of the barber, he tries all kinds of his tricks, it doesn't hurt you. But when touching the hair, he touches your ear, you shout. Why? Because the prana is there, you are there. We all know that. It's a simple day-to-day experience. But look at the amount of time and money we spent in maintaining hair and nails. It's all housekeeping, you know. Nothing beyond, nothing to do with you. So who are we? We are the pranamaya kosha. The student is unhappy, comes back to the teacher, and the life force. But the teacher says, find out further. That means you are not life force. You are not physical body, not life force. You are somebody different beyond these two. Why? Because many times physical body is there, prana is also there, but you are not there. The experience is not there. How? Like you are driving a car, physical eyes are there, prana is also there. And you see the red light in the traffic and stop that car. My God, how long this traffic, you know? I'm stuck in this traffic. Particularly this evening and Friday evening, the traffic is so hard to leave. And then we are getting late to the airport. Can I reach the airport or not? See, mind has already gone to the airport. Meanwhile, the red light has become green. You have not seen because your mind has already gone to the airport. Somebody behind you honks at you. What? You're sleeping? Suddenly you realize, oh, I was at the airport. That means mind has gone there. I've gone there. Mind is here, I'm here. So who am I? I am that mind, not the physical body. Prana. These two things are you, but I am the mind, mental personality. Mano brahmi vyajana, manasu keva kalvimani bhuta vyajayate, manasa jatani jivanti. You are the mental personality. In fact, today in my lecture, all of you are here, physical body very much here. I know very well prana is also there. I don't know whether you are there or not. But mind is here, you are here. Otherwise, you are not here. Hopefully, you are all here. The student is excited, comes back to the teacher and says that I am the mental personality. But somehow teacher is not satisfied. Find out further. He doesn't give a hint, you know. What is the next phone of friend, you know? Choices, nothing like that. Why? Because it's there in your own experience. You look into your experience, you see that you are not mind. You are somebody who is the boss of the mind, who is the leader of the mind, who is somebody settled within the mind. How? If mind goes here and there, don't you tell the mind to come back here? Isn't it? That means to say you are not mind. Mind is like a slave in your hands. Like for example, you are driving the car in a new city, new somebody who's talking to you and then your last impact, and you realize, hey, you know, now I need to take an exit, I need to take a road, I find out careful about what is the road that is there. So don't talk now, put my mind on the traffic. That means I put my mind, which is basically that mind is like an instrument in your hand. I put the pen here, I put my dress here, the shoes here. Like that I put my mind. So that means to say, I'm not the mind, but I'm somebody behind the mind. I'm the boss of the mind. I control the mind. And this is there in our own simple day-to-day experience. In order to see something beyond the mind, I don't have to go to some esoteric, some, you know, mystic ideas and all that. It's in our day-to-day experience. We are not mind. We are somebody who is behind the mind. So this question, who am I, still continues. So who is this I then? Now, a little bit of a closer look at your own nature, you can see that there's somebody behind the mind. And what is that? Like, for example, we are doing some work and somebody is doing some calculations, child is doing some calculations and then 2 multiplied by 2 is 5 and 5 plus 2 is 8. I think we are missing something there. You tell the child. Who said that? You said it. 2 multiplied by 2 is 4. Not 5. Who is that you? If you look at it, it is intellect. Intellect is the one which is responding to everything. Like a very simple thing, I ask you your name and you respond by giving your name. Who gave that name? It is the name of you. And this is what is intellect. You are all intellectual personalities. Vijnanamaya kosha. Vijnanam brahmeti vyajagana. Vijnanatheva kavimani kutari jayante. We are the intellectual personality, that's why we could make all this change and difference of the world. Today all this technology development, it is because of the intellect. We understood about the nature, it is because of the intellect. It is the intellect which is responsible for all these activities. Today, we put man on the moon, it's because of the intellect. We developed all this software, it's all because of intellect. So we have intellectual personality. And all these things, whether it is the mind or body or prana, all these things are used by intellect. So therefore, the student is excited, comes back to the teacher and says, yeah, I found out. I am the intellectual personality. We can from KB to Dhyana. But then somehow the teacher is not convinced. See, it's from find out further. That means many times, intellect also is there, but you are not there. Intellect also says something, but you take a different decision. You are not the intellect. How? I mean, it cannot be convinced, it cannot be... We never thought about it because we have so much identified ourselves with intellect. Whatever the intellect is there, that we identify ourselves with that. My intellect is trained in engineering. I'm an engineer. My intellect is trained in medicine. I'm a doctor. In fact, we write before even the name, doctor, so and so. Basically, because my intellect is trained in medicine. Whatever that intellect is trained, we identify with that. What I do, I'm a doctor. I'm an engineer. I'm a software engineer. You know, people talk about that. Whatever intellect is trained, if your intellect is trained in architecture, you are not there. Intellect is trained in engineering, you are an engineer. Intellect is trained in lying, you are a liar. You are no intellect, you are a politician. No, that's what we are. Whatever the intellect is there, we identify with that. How can there be anything such a thing but the intellect? We identify ourselves with intellect. This is where Upanishad knowledge, this way in the classical knowledge, helps us to go to understand, because intellect is not you, because intellect is not the deciding authority. Intellect can only suggest you, advise you. It's an advisor, but then who takes the advice or not, it's up to you. Many times you see intellect keeps saying something, but you do different. We all know that. When I was working as an engineer, I had a colleague of mine, a brilliant engineer, absolutely marvelous intellect, so that any engineering item that he could really solve in such a simple way. But then he was given to smoking. So one day I countered him saying that, Arey Baba, why do you smoke? Don't you know that smoking is bad for your health? In fact, you are a role model for engineers, and if you smoke, how many people will follow you? Particularly, engineers are very good when you tell them in terms of statistics. So I tried to advise him, that look, medical research reports show that 72% of the lung cancers are because of smoking. You are in the highest range of lung cancer. And then he replies to me saying that, Raghuram, 72% is earlier statistics. The revised statistics show 84%. See, he corrects my intellect. But he still goes for smoking. Why did he go for smoking? Have you thought about it? In fact, you don't have to break your head. He has an answer. I went on repeatedly telling that why do you smoke? Any good advice, anybody would tell. 3, 4, 5 times, that fellow feels really irritated. And one day he got irritated and counted me saying, that Raghuram, you advise me not to smoke. Have you ever smoked? Well, nobody asked that question, so I was taken aback. I honestly replied, no, I never smoked. He said, that's the reason why you advise me not to smoke, because you don't know the joy of smoking. See, what guides him is not the intellect, it is the joy. And that's what in Sanskrit we call it as ananda. Nobody else is guiding you. Please understand that you are guiding yourself. And who is that you who is guiding you? It is the ananda. It is the happiness. It's the bliss. Look at the way a diabetic person will go to the sweets. He knows very well sweets. Eating sweets is bad for his health. But look at the way that he goes. In fact, in Bangalore these days, marriage functions. You always have different, counters. And one counter of the sweets, and my friend who is a diabetic, three goes there to that counter. I asked him that, you know that you are not supposed to take sweet. Why do you stand here? Why do you go for sweet? He said, Raghuram, keep it later on, that question. But give me an answer. If I take one sweet, how many calories is it? I said, it's about 150 calories. So I think we do chapati and eat sweet. He uses his intellect for the sake of his eating sweet, ananda. Ananda makes use of your intellect. Ananda makes use of your body, your mind, everything. Ananda keva kalimani bhutara jayanta. Nobody else is guiding you. Deep inside, your very nature is ananda. But even then, the student is still adamant. My experience of happiness comes from the object outside. I eat something, gives me happiness. I drink something, gives me happiness. But you seem to suggest saying that my nature is happiness. Very simple idea is, you think that happiness is contributed by the object outside? The best of the happy moment that you have is when you have a wonderful sleep. You cannot compromise that happiness with anything else. You love sleep. Everybody enjoys sleep. I don't think there is anybody who doesn't enjoy sleep. 7 hours, 8 hours a day. If you have greater stamina, 14, 15 hours a day, you can manage. And what is the joy that you get in the sleep state? No object is coming in between you, joy. Not only that they can't give you joy, the object cannot add to your happiness. Like you are nicely sleeping, enjoying the sleep, your mother feels that, she improved your happiness. So, fresh rasagulla, she makes it, puts it in your mouth. You shout it, saying that, throw this nonsense, don't distract. That means no object can add joy to you. Joy is your own nature. What a wonderful Vedic idea. The moment that the Upanishad teacher says that student finds out his nature is happiness, he never came back to the teacher. Saisha, Bhargavi, Varuni, Vidya, Paramaya, Yohan, Pratishtha. Your nature is happiness. In fact, to tell you frankly, with all our Indian friends, in all our marriages, the priest would have chanted all these mantras. All these mantras, whatever that I said, in bits and pieces, they would have chanted. Unfortunately, the priest doesn't know what he's chanting. People who are listening to do not know what he is chanting. But otherwise, this is the idea. It says that your nature is happiness. You don't have to go outside for the sake of happiness. Well, it's so convincing. It's so simple. In fact, I have not used any mystic word to understand this particular thing. The only mystic word idea is this way. A normal happiness is supposed to be something where you interact with the object and you get that happiness. Like you eat an ice cream, you get happiness. Or you drink some coffee, it gives me happiness. But ananda is no object is there in between you and experience called happiness. You are happy. That's what is the same. That's what is called as ananda. Bliss. Well, it's wonderful. But there's a big danger. So what is the danger? In this creation of God, everything is according to its nature. Like the nature of a rose plant is to be rose flower. The rose plant will not say, this is not the reason for roses, this is the reason for lilies. Season for lily, so let me give lily, doesn't change its nature. The nature of the bird is to swim and fly in the air, fishes to swim in the water, they know next day their nature. Everything is according to its nature. Excepting the most wonderful creation of God, human being. Nature is happiness, perpetually unhappy. Look at him, are you happy? Anybody, you ask, are you happy? Yeah, next month I'm going on vacation, then I will be happy. Are you happy? Yeah, I applied for a job in Bay Area, then I will be happy, not here. A person who is ready to get married, once I'm married, then I will be happy. A person who is married looking for a divorce, then I will be happy. Everybody is happy from happiness. A friend of mine in Bangalore mental hospital in Hans, he took me to the bar. There's a young fellow pulling his hair, tearing his clothes and all that. He was having a picture in his hand. I asked him, this young fellow, what happened to him? He said, you know, that fellow was in love with that girl. And that girl married somebody else, so he became mad. He's unhappy, he's crying and all that. I felt sorry about it. And then we went to the next cell, where another young fellow was there. He was also pulling his hair, tearing his clothes and crying. I said, is that similar case? No, no, that girl married him. Either way, you're unhappy. This is what happens. We are all away from the nature of our happiness. Why? Because today, all these personalities are the next slide. We have come away from our nature. At the physical personal level, the body, our nature was to be relaxed. Look at the children, how relaxed that they are. The body to be relaxed is a natural state. They walk relaxed, run relaxed, they fall relaxed. They won't even have tension when they fall. Children, they are free to fall. Whereas, we have grown out of it. Tension is the way. A simple sign of relaxation at the body level is any child anywhere in the world, you put them in the lateral position, simple posture of the child, is to take the big toes and put it in the mouth. The child becomes like a ball. Because muscles are so relaxed and the joints are so relaxed, the child becomes like a ball. We were also doing like that when we were children, but now we have grown big, so far away. People come for yoga classes and then they say, come on, let's do Padmasana, bend forward, hold the toes. Half of them can actually hear the toes are because of my prosperous. But those who can see the toes also say that those toes, as if it's somebody else doesn't know about your own toes. How can I hold my toes? Because my hands do not go below the knees. Why? Because the joints are tight, muscles are tight, you know, tension. We have not relaxed. But then you are putting the toes in your mouth as a child. What happened today? Huh? I can do social service. Seva. I can put my toes in somebody else's mouth. This is how we have come away from our nature. At the prana level, life force level, our nature was to be slow. Show me one child in the space of earth who is fast. No child is in a hurry. Every child takes his own time. But if you go to the shopping place, the child will never come out. At least a mother 100 times shouts at the child, come on, walk fast. No child walks fast. That's it. You keep the spoonful of food in the mouth of the child takes 1, 2, 3 minutes and mother says, open the mouth, food is still sitting there. Mother says, come on, eat it fast. I don't know why the child has to eat fast, but you introduce the speed like that. And today, we are so fast. Everything has to be so fast. And that speed is not in the world outside. You bring the world outside because the world is fast. But actually, it is inside fast which is creating the problem. Because outside has speeded up twice, inside has speeded up 20 times. In fact, you know, their most difficult situation is in the traffic jam. And there is the outside speed. It's nothing, but inside speed is so much. You can't bear with that. You are beating yourself. Inside speed is what is really causing us to happen. At the mind level, our nature was to be calm. Children are never worried. In fact, I was in Atlanta, my cousin's place. Friday evening, we were having dinner. And then the child was playing. The mother said to the child, hey, tomorrow you have a soccer game. He said, yes. What? Yes. You have to prepare your shoes, your socks, and your kit, your wash water. He said, yes, 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 correct. And then she said, keep all those things ready today. Don't bother me tomorrow. He said, yes to that also. And then she said, next morning, got up. And then happily playing. Mother said, hey, come on, we are supposed to go to soccer. He said, yes. But I don't know. It's simple answer. I told you yesterday in Sarkitik everything ready. He said, yes. But then why did you not keep it ready? I don't know. But he is not even bothered now. She has to prepare everything. I told her, anyway you have to prepare everything. Let it be peaceful. Because later on, he will also worry. You are also peaceful like that. Now you worry about it. We worry. There is nothing to worry. We sit down and worry. I think something wrong with me because I'm not worrying about anything. Is it necessary? Unnecessary to keep worrying. In fact, a couple of months back, I had been invited to Prashanti. Prashanti is our residential campus, where we have 200-bed Yoga Therapy Hospital is there. It's a beautiful setup, you must come to see that. All kinds of modern ailments we treat with the help of yoga. And there, I had been invited again. And then, usually when they come to me for counseling, you know, ideas, and all that. And then they came to me and talked for about 10-15 minutes afterwards. Wife told husband, come and you go out, because I want to talk personally to Raghuram. Then the husband also went out, and then her question was, my main worry is my husband doesn't worry. Somebody doesn't worry, then becomes your worry. This is how we have come away from our nature. At the mind level, peaceful nature was our mind, was our nature, but we are worrying. Like, you know, somebody was asking, what is the topic that tomorrow you are talking? And I don't worry about it. Why do you see about that? See, not worry. At the intellect level, we have wrong notions, fixations. How many types of fixations which have absolutely no reason at all? You go for an interview, start with the right leg forward. Why not left leg? I mean, you just made a created a kind of thing and then you get fixed up on that particular thing. How many such fixations that we have created ourselves? Wrong notions. At the emotional level, emotional balances. This is how we are come away from our nature. At the deep level, the bliss level, our nature must be in harmony. Look at the whole creation. The whole creation is in harmony. We also have that harmony within us. A simple harmony we can think of is the harmony in the plant between the roots and the fruits. And that's what is the health of the plant. I mean, the roots have never seen where the fruits are. Fruits never know where the energy comes from. But look at the harmony that exists, that harmony. In fact, you look at things, no, they're all right, but they are not opposite qualities. Look at a magnet, North Pole and South Pole are such wonderful harmony. Have you ever thought about it? If you take an orange, the bitter seed inside and the wonderful sweet fruit, they are born together, grow to the fullness together. The seed will not disturb the fruit, nor the fruit will disturb the seed. They are in such wonderful harmony. That harmony is essential feature of the health of the fruit. So in the nature there was such harmony everywhere. In fact, a simple harmony is harmony between hunger and eating. You know, these days in YouTube you have all this wonderful information. I was watching in one of the YouTube small little things where a tiger having nice wonderful food was sleeping in the grass. The deer did not realize that tiger is sleeping. Raging in that grass, so close to the tiger, inches in. And because the tiger got disturbed, raised his head, looked at the deer, and you can see in the deer also the fear that was there, because after all the deer very well knows, so close to the tiger, the prey is. It is like the way ready meal from microwave. But then the tiger's stomach was full, just yawned and slept back. And the tiger did. Slept well, the deer also did not run away from there, just grazing there itself. And the commentator said very nice, he said, the tigers are not violent. They eat their food only when they are hungry. You see, please note that statement, because violence does not mean whether you eat meat or not, but violence means basically whether you are hungry and eat or whether you are not hungry and eat. How much disharmony we have created. See, this is how we are far away from our nature, our bliss. So far away, so much disturbance, disharmony that we created, that a simple sign of happiness, the bliss, is to have a smile on the face, isn't it? But we are so far away today. The cameraman has to make a request to you, please smile, as if we are doing a favor to him. Even that does not work, that fellow says, say cheese, and you can't do that. What an unfortunate thing. How far away we have come from? So then what is the solution? Solution is not to find out the object outside there is happiness. Because if happiness is inside, you are searching for outside. This is what Indian philosophers do. They say, look for the sake of happiness, that means go back to your nature. At every personal level, go back to your nature. At the body level, physical body level, go back to your nature. That means to say, a conscious process of relaxation is the way that you go back to your nature. And that's what is the very definition of asanas. The yoga practice is called asanas. The very definition is sthira sukham asanam. A conscious method of relaxation is the definition of asana. If you have practiced one of our asana, yoga positions, and at the end of it you say, ah, I've done yoga, now let me relax. That means you have not done yoga. The very fact that you have done yoga should relax. A conscious process of slowing down the prana is the technique called as pranayama. Shwasa prashwasa yoga gati cheta prana. Patanjali gives us this definition. A conscious method of slowing down your inner activity, slowing down. That's what it is doing, relaxation at the body level, at the prana level. Similarly, a conscious process of calming down the mind is the technique of meditation. Any meditation on this earth that you take is a technique where you consciously calm down your mind. If you are sitting for meditation and then waiting, when does this meditation get over? When does, then you are not doing meditation. You have to be calm. Similarly, a conscious process of correcting your intellect is Dhyana Yoga. A conscious process of correcting your emotions is Bhakti Yoga. So all these techniques of yoga are essentially a conscious process of taking you back to your own nature. Because your nature is bliss. When you do all those things, bliss becomes your own nature. Happiness is not a product of something else from outside. It's not a result. It's your own nature. All other things are removed that you are happy. That's what is the state of what you go into. But then, one question that comes up, relaxation, slowness, calmness, these are the things which are taking us back to our natural state. Tension, speed, agitation, they are taking you away from your natural state. Now look at what is the definition of stress in the modern terminology. The stress itself is where you are away from your nature. This is what is the definition in the modern medicine given by Dr. Selly and Bailey. This is an altered condition is what is called as stress. For some reason or the other, your situation is altered. Like for example, normal BP is supposed to be our natural state. But abnormal BP is an altered condition. And that's why they say you are under stress. Similarly, diabetes. The blood energy is there within you, and then your requirement is there, and then there is a balance, and that is the normal nature. But then you are tired, you have in the form of sugar in your body, in your blood, but that cannot become the harmonious, and that's what is diabetes. It's an abnormal condition. This is what. All the conditions of altered state is what is called as stress. When you look at it, stress is something which is because of you are going away from your nature. When you look at all these things, then you see that basically the whole practice of yoga is trying to get back to your nature. That's why somebody gave a very beautiful definition. Yoga is a conscious process of going back to our own natural state. Actually, when you look at it, tension, speed, agitation, these are all doings. Relaxation, slowness, calmness, they're all states of being. So yoga and tension, speed is all work out. The relaxation, slowness, calmness is work in. But unfortunately, today in America, I go everywhere, I see yoga work out. I mean, life has enough work does out. Now we need to work in. It's not doing, it is undoing. Somebody gave a very beautiful definition. Yoga is a conscious journey from doing to being. A very beautiful idea. Conscious journey from doing to being. We are wrongly called as human beings. The way that we are, we should be called as human doing. And if you do yoga, you become human being. So in order to become our own nature, our own blissful state, we need to do yoga. This is what we are doing. This is what is different from the totally all the kinds of physical exercise. This whole science of getting back to your nature, that's what is basically the idea of yoga. And in fact, I tell you that there is no other technique which can really help you come back to your own nature other than the ideas of yoga. It has nothing to do with any particular religion, culture, anything like that. It's a science. Why did we come away from that nature? Every child is relaxed, slow, peaceful, blissful. And you know, whenever you see the child, you feel, how I wish this child continues to be like that. But you forget that your grandmother also thought about you when you were a child. But then you have come away from that. Why it happened like that? The child is born relaxed, slow, calm, peaceful and all that. But the child does not know that was a great treasure. Normally what we are born with, you do not know the value of it. Like the fish in the water does not know the value of the water. Only the fish comes out of the water will know what the value of the water is. Similarly, the rich parents, children do not know the value of the money. Parents will be shocked at the children, so you are spending the money like water. Tomorrow when you start earning it, you will know the value of it. What you have not earned, you do not know the value of it. What you got it free of charge, you do not know the value of it. Mullah Nasruddin was walking in the forest. Robbers stopped him on the way, showed him a dagger and said, take away all the money and jewelry, otherwise I take your life. Mullah replied him, don't touch my money and jewelry, they're hard work. Take my life, I got it free of charge. The same way what we got it free of charge, we let it go. Now we consciously practice it, and that's what is most important practice in yoga, which is different from the physical exercise. We go to the gym, do the physical exercise, the body needs exercise. I'm not against it. And there, one thing is that your awareness is not necessary. You know, you'll be doing all that exercise, music is going on in your ear, your attention is there on the TV that you are watching, fine. But yoga is not like that. You have to watch yourself with awareness.